those on occasion. I've played one or two video games in my time. What's the best one, Herbie?
Best video game?
Yeah.
Ooh, that's a tough one.
Brandon?
The best video game.
Yeah, which one is it? You're right, it's Evo, Search for Eden.
Oh, wasn't a bad one.
Hi, welcome to our... Yeah, it was pretty bad, actually.
There's a part of me that for some reason, my mind went to Tetris Attack.
Tetris Attack is really good, though. Oh, man.
Oh, wow, you guys are gonna love the newspaper this week.
There's a place here in town that has regular Tetris Attack tournaments.
Oh, man. Yeah. I was a basement king at Tetris Attack.
I mean, holy crap.
I hate you, openly and without regret.
Yeah.
What's... Oh, bless you.
Thank you.
Are you allergic to Lakitus?
What?
Are you allergic to Lakitus? It's a simple question.
What the hell is a Lakitu?
It's one of those fisherman turtles from Mario Brothers.
In the cloud.
In the cloud.
Oh, those guys. No, yeah. I'm not allergic to those.
Like Bill Gates. Up in the cloud.
But...
Like
you're,
up.
You're gonna like. You guys are gonna like this week's newspaper.
Tell me about the newspaper.
It has
dead
three movie. Animal stories in it, at least. They are. A child stolen by a monkey.
A child stolen by a monkey!
Fatal encounter with a shark.
Fatal encounter with a shark!
And a boy mistaken for a crow. Oh, wait, four!
Four!
Animal stories. A boy mistaken for a crow.
Boy mistaken for a crow.
Well, he did want them
and
to give him smooth.
Jaguarina.
Jaguarina?
Yeah.
I believe. Maybe Huagarina.
Maybe.
What's the story
it's
with...
It's a story about a luchador.
Yeah.
Actually, it is a story about a Spanish swordswoman. You were...
Oh!
Are they a red mage?
I don't know.
What do they think of Evo, Search for Eden?
I don't know. Maybe that's in the shark story. Or the child stolen by a monkey
well,
story.
Well, I was about to say, if the shark also, has, 50 horns on it, you know.
A Lola version of a shark. Lobos is sick this week, so we're one man down, but we're trucking on. Also, we're sorry if you're watching live and we're early and you're missing all these great animal stories, of which we haven't actually read any. We've just gone through the highlights, so maybe as the stream goes on, we'll pick up where we left off there with the good content, talking about... Yes, what are you looking for?
Well, pencil and paper for you guys.
Well, there's notebooks right there. You could pass me one of those.
There was one pencil and I swiped it.
There was. I can't believe you. There's probably a big stack of them next to that map over there that I was drawing for the thing.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Now we're cooking with pencils. What?
I mean, they're made of wood. That
sure.
Works.
They could serve as tinderfoots. All right, we've got our pencils, we've got our pencil sharpener, we've got a mystery to solve, boys.
We've also got a polo.
Polo, we've got a mystery to solve.
What's the name of the mystery anyway?
The mystery this week is the ninth case in this series. It is called The Savage Club. Ooh. A story about a shark that mauled a man. It takes place on Friday, September 30th, 1898. We're riding along with Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson in a carriage whose cover has been drawn down. It's one of these magnificent autumn days the gods grant us to prepare for the languor of cold winter. There's a hint of warmth to put its coolness into context, and just enough cloud cover to soften the flaming noon sun. The carriage turns onto Regent Street toward our destination, the Savage Club. Holmes has remained quiet since he came on board, paying more attention to the buzzing crowds than he is to us. "What do you know of the Savage Club, Dr. Watson?" asks Wiggins. "Is it a club dedicated to the study of aboriginals?" "No, Wiggins. Its name has an origin in an actor and a writer from the last century, Richard Savage." "Murder and a crook, as far as I'm concerned," Holmes laughs. He talks to us for the first time. "You should note the humor in choosing this dubious actor for a name. The club's founder, Augustus Sala, didn't want to turn it into one of those pretentious clubs from the West End. He wanted to advance creativity and good company over belonging to a particular social class." "It's open to anyone who's left a mark in the world of the arts," admits Watson. "I thought you were a member already, Watson, with the stories you were telling which were so popular in the Strand." "Really, Holmes, my stories are only the retelling of your adventures, and are meant to be lessons on the methods on your methods for the public. Nothing more. Come now, Watson, you're too modest. Your stories deserve to enter the pantheon of literature. Really, Holmes? Of course, Watson. If melodrama is an art form, you've elevated it to its peak. He gives the good doctor a pat on the back. Holmes, really, says Watson, not really appreciating his friend's joke. We've arrived at the Savage Club. The carriage stops in front of the dike in front of the Adelphi Terrace at 92 Robert Street, WC. Holmes leads us in front of the Roman-style building and shows the doorman the telegram which brought us together. Doorman lets us in and leads us into the stairway, which leads in turn to the office of Augustus Sala, founder and director of the Savage Club.
Ah, oh, Mr. Holmes, I'm glad you were able to come so quickly.
Sala is a short man of 75 years, but he has the agile eye of someone half his age. His long white hair contrasts with his bushy black eyebrows. He greets each of us in turn while still talking to Holmes.
Believe me, we're in dire need of someone in your talents. This case is of major importance.
Sala shakes his head and walks out of the office, inviting us to follow him.
One of our most prestigious members needs your help. He's waiting for us in the library.
We take a flight of steps and end up facing the large wooden door bearing a brass plate on which is engraved, Library. Augustus Sala opens the door for us, and we enter the oak wainscoted room. The leather seats, stuffed and seemingly very comfortable, are unoccupied. At the other end of the room, a person is sitting on a sofa, stands up as we arrive. His face, decorated with an impeccably cut graying beard, is known throughout the kingdom. It's His Royal Highness, the Prince of Wales. Another animal. We freeze and take a respectful posture towards the speaker, with the exception of Holmes, who heads straight over to the prince. With a slight nod of his head, he extends his hand and tells him, I suppose that your highness needs my help.
I hope you will be able to give it to me, Mr. Holmes. I really hope so. The voice of the future king shows deep fatigue.
Tell us all about the case in detail, and I'll see what I can do. The prince turns to us, greeting us with a head gesture. Unlike Holmes, we make a bow as a response to that salutation. My associates are indispensable to me in my investigations, and their discretion is faultless. Sit down. He himself dives back into the sofa. He takes a cigar from a leather-covered box and offers one to Holmes, who gratefully accepts it. Each lights their cigar and takes in the scent of the tobacco. I'm listening, Your Highness. As you certainly know, says the prince, I had the reputation of being a womanizer in my youth. Thankfully, or unfortunately, all of these stories are untrue. The prince lets out a slight unconscious snicker. We do the same. My mother has never found these stories funny, and I must admit that with age I tend to see it her way. It's true that I'll shortly be king. What little freedom I still have will evaporate, and all of my actions will be examined through the public microscope. Let's come to the point, Your Highness, Holmes interrupts. I've recently bought the Akbar Shah diamond from Christine's. Yes, I know. There's an article about that in the Times. It was stolen. And, we need to find it? No! I know who has the diamond. Lily Longtree, the American actress. She has the necklace as well as a few letters written by my hand. Letters which could turn out to be embarrassing if they are ever made public. Holmes exhales a long cloud of smoke and shakes his head. I'm sorry, Your Highness, but there are many men much more capable than I am in this sort of matter. I don't do private indiscretions. You need someone to negotiate. Holmes is on the verge of getting up when Sala intervenes.
Please, Mr. Holmes, you misunderstand. The diamond was stolen from the club's safe. His Highness has only met Lily Longtree at public receptions. There is no relation of a personal nature.
And the letters? Written to another woman a long time ago.
How did she get these letters?
Stolen. From whom? I couldn't tell you. Is Lily Longtree trying to blackmail you?
Not specifically. When I heard that she had the diamond, and how did you hear that?
Lord Cantlemere told me. That's cant, like thieves cant. L-E, so like candle, but with a T. Mere. He saw Miss Longtree wearing the necklace during Sir Everard Hancock's dinner. When he asked her how she'd gotten it, she answered that I had given it to her. Lord Cantlemere was bewildered. He didn't know what to do. I don't either, by the way. And what did you do?
Augustus contacted Miss Longtree. Augustus, tell them. I went to see Miss Longtree, and I asked her how she came to have the Akbar Shah. She laughed. Don't you read the newspapers? It was a gift from the Prince of Wales. She nicknamed the prince My Little Tam Tam. What impudence! Shouts the prince. He leaps out of the cigar and takes a few steps. The tip of his right foot quickly taps on the ground as he draws long puffs from the cigar. He turns to Holmes. You must help me, Holmes. The prince sighs deeply and heads to the window overlooking the Thames, turning his back to us. We follow Holmes, leaving the prince to his thoughts.
Tam
Tams. My goodness. There's quite some drama afoot.
No kidding.
Yes.
Oh, that's that guy with the mask from Samurai Showdown.
Yes. Not the green man who's married. Yes.
Well, I'm looking through the paper to see if there's a Times edition that actually has something about that in it.
Hmm.
Not finding it, though.
Hmm.
Oh, that was the 19th.
Hmm.
Well, I don't see any other ones that are relevant, so we can check this one out later, maybe. As far as this one goes, seems to be one of those weird cases of the paper doesn't notably have anything directly related so far, other than the massive number of animal stories.
May I?
Yes.
Local paper reports a somewhat remarkable case of the purloining of a child, which occurred in the small village of Manxbridge in Somerset on Monday last. It appears that Mr. Judicote, a gentleman of independent means, has for a long time past kept a large monkey, who has been accustomed to range over his master's garden and grounds. As the creature was deemed harmless, and to use a sporting phrase, was deemed to be free of vice. On Monday last, Mrs. Hemingway, near the neighbor of Mr. Judicote, was walking in a garden, was surprised and horrified at beholding Hulch, Mr. Judicote's monkey, suddenly snatch a baby from the arms of her youngest sister, Clara, who, as a special favor, had been permitted to take charge of the infant. The monkey, gibbering and chattering, rushed off with its prize and climbed onto the roof of an outhouse with very little difficulty. Mrs. Hemingway was driven to the utmost despair. She vainly strove to repossess her last board. She beheld, to her infinite horror, the monkey pass over the roof of the outhouse until he and his burden were both lost to sight. The anxious mother at once hastened to the house of her neighbor, Mr. Judicote, who appeared to be as much troubled as herself at this undesired disaster. His manservants were dispatched in every direction in search of Hulch, who was, however, too wary to allow his hiding place to be discovered. In the meantime, the parents of the child remain in a constant state of anxiety and trepidation. It is impossible to say what had fallen behind the child. The day passed without any news of either Hulch or the infant. And it was by the nearest chance that both fugitives were discovered by some farm laborers in an adjacent wood towards 8 o'clock in the evening. At this time, Hulch seemed to be tired of his companion, whom he had purposely resigned to the farm servants. The delight of the parents upon regaining their child may more readily imagined than described. Monkeys. They must be eliminated.
Monkeys.
For the safety of the human race.
Well,
I've seen those movies.
Yeah.
Polo agrees. Down with monkeys. Down with monkeys. Holmes, you have to do something. All right. We've got a number of leads here.
Indeed.
We've got this American actress, Polo. We've got Lord Cantlemere. We have Sir Everard Hancock.
Who is Hancock? I'm sorry.
Hancock is the fellow who was hosting the dinner where someone was spotted wearing the necklace. I'm going to investigate if Polo sees a monkey in the trees.
Okay.
Polo.
The name of a robot in my D&D thing that I did on the internet.
Yep, I found a monkey.
Yay. Hello. Polo,
we have to solve the mystery. All right, where are we going? Bringing Polo.
Okay, good question. I guess we could start with, You know, it's a funny thing. We usually resort to the back of the book guys relatively midway or late. By that point, they aren't usually able to help us much. This seems like a case where the society columnist guy might actually be an excellent first stop.
I think Langdale is absolutely who we need to speak to.
Because for all this guy said, oh, I never, you know, I wasn't a womanizer. He clearly wrote letters to somebody and doesn't seem to remember who or is willing to say.
What a lady. Iser. A lady Iser.
So, Langdale Pike at 2 Southwest?
Yes, absolutely.
You want to take the lead?
Sure. Let me just write down. I gotta keep track of where we're going, though.
Polo, keep track of where we're going.
Okay.
Polo, you're such a good boy. How could you possibly be a monkey? How could you be a monkey?
Okay.
Polo, what are you gonna do?
It's just gonna hang out, it looks like.
I guess so. Polo, you have to help us solve the mystery.
That's actually calmer than I would have expected him to be for this long during...
He's such a good boy.
...during a holding pattern exercise.
Polo, do you want some milkshake condensation? Langdale Pike it is.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, well, here we go.
Alright.
It was me! I did it!
Langdale is alone in one of the small antechambers off the main lounge of the Society's clubhouse. He's sitting at his desk, making a long mauve quill glide across his lavender-covered letterhead. Wiggins coughs to announce our presence. One moment, my boy, one short moment. Langdale doesn't look up from his work. He dips the tip of the feather in a bottle of violet ink and ends his letter with a few decorative flourishes. There, my dear, I'm all yours. Langdale gets up from his desk, takes Wiggins by the shoulders, and kisses him softly on each cheek. Yeah, I'm just reading what's here, guys.
No, that's fine.
He wears a house coat with cashmere patterns featuring various shades of violet. It covers, though fails to completely hide, his pajamas of the purest Parisian-style violet silk. Wiggins' face takes a similar violet tone, but his smile is frank and natural. Hello, Langdale. You're right on time for my second tea. Some think that art is a muse, Wiggins, fed with inspiration and talent, and that's no doubt true. But high-class rumors, my dear, are a pleasure which is fed with small cakes and whispered secrets.
Polo, cakes.
Yeah. I hope you deserve your cakes, Wiggins. Polo definitely deserves his cakes.
Polo, you're gonna get so many cakes. What a good boy.
At that moment, a young boy in white livery brings a cart covered with a tea set and various pastries.
Huh.
I see that you thought of my friend, Jamie, says Langdale as he notices there's a cup for each of us.
Huh.
Yes, sir. Brave boy. Huh. The young man pours tea in each of the cups, leaving his master free for his favorite occupation, talking. Who are you working for, Henry? I don't know if I should tell you, Langdale. Our client is rather highly placed on the social ladder. Wiggins keeps his eyes on the cup as he carefully stirs his tea with his silver spoon, but his smile shows us that he appreciates that little game which Pike enjoys so much. Lord Kentlemere? No, a bit higher. Wiggins hides a satisfied smile by drinking a sip of tea. Langdale's frowning eyebrows show that he managed to get all of his attention. It couldn't be a member of the royalty, asks Langdale incredulously. Purrs Wiggins. Aha! Explodes Langdale. He puts down his cup and focuses all of his attention on Wiggins.
Ah, there's Langdale everywhere.
As Clarence is no longer among us, it must be about the Prince of Wales himself. It could be, but you need to keep that a secret, Langdale. Mm. Of course, my boy, I'm discretion made flesh. We know your reputation very well, Langdale. Could you answer a few of our questions? What can you tell us about Lily Longtree and her relations with the prince? Ah, Lily the Divine. Our American cousin has blown a tempestuous wind through our fair city, or at the very least through its male population. And I'd go so far as to say that through the better-known upper-crust society males. She seems to have left her love for democracy behind in her native country. She's interested in people of rank, and of the highest rank if possible. And there's no higher rank than the princess, says Wiggins. Did she bring herself up to that level? Yes, if she's to be believed. And can she be believed? Ah, Wiggins, what would your mentor answer to such a question? I might only be a poor journalist, a writer gifted in entertaining the masses, but I never believe anyone with just a word. I look for proof, for confirmation. Lily Longtree claims that she's having a love affair, but I have the feeling that it's more an affair of interest than of love. What proof do you have? None, my dear. Only a sharp pain in my bacilla oblongata, a pain which has taught me over the years to be wary of people who tell me their stories a bit too ostentatiously. She made a great deal of effort to appear to be an intimate of the prince. We wonder why he's remained quiet. Maybe you could tell me, Wiggins. Maybe he believes that silence is the best answer he could give. Maybe he's right, says Langdale. It didn't do him any good to make statements in the past. Do you have any other stories about the prince? Wiggins puts down his cup and pulls out a notebook and a pencil. He considers Sarah Bernhardt and Miss Kepner his closest friends, though he hasn't had much been in contact with the latter for many years. Wiggins writes the names down in his notebook, and after a few words on other topics, we leave Langdale to his feather. So, while that was certainly a whole lot of interesting stuff, I think it was only the last little bit at the end that actually was identifiably helpful.
Well, it confirms that probably he's not actually having an affair with this actress and just trying to hide it from us.
Indeed. Well, we have two new names from him.
Yep.
And we also, of course, have the many, many ones from four.
I think speaking to Lord Cantlemere would be a wise next step.
I have no arguments with that. Oh, did you find something in here? I noticed there was some...
I didn't find anything, no.
Oh, okay.
All I found out is that we need an elephantine trunk guaranteed to hold at least 1/10 of a fashionable lady's traveling wardrobe.
That's a fair bit. Lord Cantlemere can be found at 55 Southwest. Lord Cantlemere greets us in the bedroom of his London residence. He's a tall man in his 60s, with the reserved manners of a high-ranking military official. The Prince of Wales told me about your impossible visit. How may I be of use to you? We were given to believe that you've seen Lily Longtree wearing the Akbar Shah. Absolutely! Could you tell us about it in detail? Of course, if such is the will of the Prince! It was at the dinner held in Sir Everard Hancock's residence. Lily Longtree was one of the guests. She was wearing the prince's jewels. She made no effort to hide them. Quite the opposite. I was at the Savage Club the night when the prince learned of the diamond's disappearance and was therefore quite shocked. But this affair has not been leaked among the members of the club, has it? That's right. But as it happens that I'm the treasurer, and as such, I have a combination to the safe. I was, by that very fact, implicated in the investigation. A terrible story, I tell you. That's it.
Hmm. Well, we learned he has access to the safe.
We did.
What did he say his position in the club was?
Treasurer. Excuse me. Treasurer! Not a lot.
Indeed. Not a lot.
What about, to continue this path down the informants, perhaps it'd be worth learning more about this particular diamond, if there's something to be known about that. In which case, a visit to the library might be worthwhile.
Maybe, but... Is its history really that important other than the immediate history?
Not sure.
I mean, it's a valuable diamond regardless of its...
It's very rare that I run into a diamond that has a name.
Give it a shot, I guess.
Maybe there's a stronger lead, but if there is, I'm not sure what it is. There's not a whole lot to go on with this one. I guess we could speak to the guy that was hosting the party. That would certainly be worthwhile.
Yeah, that...
Or the ladies we picked up from the... In the Langdale.
Yep, we could speak to his friends. We could also try and see if Miss Lovetree herself has an address.
Also, I'd be interested to know how the safe was entered. I mean, they said it was stolen from the safe. Was the safe broken into, or did they have proper access and abuse that, or...
Yes, indeed.
I don't know if forensics might tell us something about that or not.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, either that
or... Well, I don't think they've reported it to the police.
Oh, that's right, they said they haven't.
Yeah.
Right, okay, in which case, the only way to do that would be to actually look at the location.
Which, you know, going to the scene of the crime is usually a good idea. But
we haven't actually been to the scene of the crime.
Except for the fact that we kind of went there in the opening, which worries me a little, that it might be one of those, we were just here, what are you back here for, kind of leads.
I don't know.
They do give us the address. Wasn't it 92 in WC, or am I wrong?
Yeah, I'm sure it's in here as well.
Savage.
Oh. Or we could talk to Sarah Bernhardt or Miss Kepner. They might have some idea where those letters originally were sent.
Yes.
I mean, they'd have to be able to see the letters, right? I mean, the only person that's going to know who the letters are to, unless he's only written, like, three letters in his lifetime.
Yeah. Well, see, that's kind of what I'm thinking. He says he wasn't a womanizer. Maybe that's true. Although it would be still odd that he can't remember who the letters were to, although he may not have seen the letters himself.
I think it's more that he didn't want to tell us who the letters were to.
Like, right.
That's more the impression I got. His friends might be a little less discerning.
Sure. But even then, it's just of, like, can you tell someone that he might have written letters to that this other actress might have? The address of the Savage Club is 92 WC, and I think it's worth a try.
Okay.
Let's take a look.
Also, not that big a surprise, but there's no address for Longtree in here, which means that to find her address, we might have to hit the American Embassy or maybe the theaters. Indeed.
Okay, so here at 92 WC, Mr. Sella takes us into his office, where the safe which contained the diamond barely a week ago is located. Why was the diamond at the club? Yeah, I forgot how his voice goes.
Kind of Harvey Firestein, kind of like a goblin, like a goblin of a man.
Very friend of the arts.
Perfect.
And Lotus the diamond. sorry.
No, it's fine.
Still getting over last week.
Please don't die.
All right, that's sufficient. It was only supposed to take the last few weeks. Other than you, who knows the combination to the safe?
Oh. You don't have to do the voice or it's going to kill you.
Only Lord Cavalier, the club's treasurer.
We'll just retcon it to where he himself also had allergies, but he's now coughed them out, so he sounds fine.
Do you have any ideas as to the burglar's modus operandi, asked Wiggins. It seems to me that the diamond was stolen during your reception. Awesome. Oh, that's true. Oh, I'm a great.
Oh.
I just, you know.
No, you're good. You're good.
And Lord Candlemere was with us the whole night. No way of opening the safe with a key, and no trace of tampering, continues Wiggins. This is the work of an experienced professional. So. Sorry about all of the plans.
That's
which,
fine.
But we did learn some things.
I did find something in a newspaper
that
Excellent.
Might be of some relevance. Auction at Christie's. The high point of the auction held Saturday at the sales room of Christie and Manson was the purchase of the famous Akbar Shah by His Royal Highness the Prince of Wales.
All right.
The diamond, put on sale by Prince Sawaji Rayo III, has been sold for £30,000. A broker won the auction, acting for the prince, but the identity of his client was known. Many other jewels were put on sale, but what caught the attention of the public was the collection of watercolors and ancient and new carvings by Charles Augustus Howell. The collection contains many portraits, as well as illustrations of the Flemish, Dutch, and Italian schools. And this was a paper from, not even 2 weeks ago.
All right. Matt?
Which is interesting, because that means this... It's interesting, because that means this thing came together pretty quick.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
And this was not some long-planned theft. They had literally a week and a half, and that's it.
Unless the prince is in on it.
Which, if it was just getting it out of the safe, a week and a half would be believable. But the whole thing with also having the letters, knowing that he was going to end up with it, having letters so that they could, you know, use this particular ploy, it's all very interesting.
I would like to, did we somehow miss the story of being attacked by a bear?
No, I talked about it last week.
Okay.
I always go through it for animals.
Okay.
It's right below Professor Layton and the Mysterious.
Yes.
There's also the
Good.
Hour of the Wolves, which
yes.
I was trying to
mention. Yes!
All right. I think that trying to track down this thing young miss and try and see if she can give us some manner of information might be worthwhile.
Might be. Do we have something else we can do in the meantime? The reason I ask is I feel like I or somebody else should go through the newspapers, make sure there's not like a theater that she's been mentioned at before we hit the embassy.
I just flipped through a bunch of them looking specifically for that, but okay. I didn't find anything.
Fair enough. Then in that case, the embassy is probably not a bad place to try.
All right. Can you check the American embassy for me? I don't know why I'm... What?
I was making pawing motions for the book.
Oh, is it your turn?
Yeah.
My bad.
American Embassy is at 18 Southwest.
Okay, American Embassy. At 18 Southwest. Okay. Sorry, my turn is always a little longer because of writing things.
Alright.
18 Southwest. Oh, here we go. Well, to tell the truth, Miss Longtree has had problems in the past. She was arrested in Chicago in 92 for illicit behavior, if you know what I mean. Once again in Boston in 94, and once for blackmail 2 years ago in New York. How is it that you have so much information about her? Do you do deep research on every American that lands on our shores? No, of course not, answers John Forsythe. Pinkerton has been hired to keep an eye on Miss Longtree and her lover, David Laws. It would seem that they conned many people in New York. Can you tell me where Miss Longtree is residing at this moment? Yes, at the Grand Hotel. And Mr. Laws? According to my report, in the same place.
Aha!
Breaking the laws!
Yes. That's them.
There was a whole lot of good information in that, despite its relatively short size.
That's what she said?
I doubt it.
Yeah, I rarely talk to her these days anyway. What?
So,
the Grand Hotel!
WC.
22 WC! Step on it, Wiggins!
For some reason, my mind went to Wiggins stepping on a bear and then also a monkey.
He's too big! He's too big! Yes.
I want to know what that picture is! I refuse to look at it in case it's a
clue. Me too! Me too is the thing, but it's a very interesting picture. It appears to be a picture of Holmes casting a spell with words.
Yeah, I saw that one, but I was completely avoiding it.
It looks like it's supposed to be like their version of like the Mind Palace from the ridiculous Sherlock show. Anyway, Wiggins knocks on the door. The groom told us belongs to Lily Longtree. Door opens suddenly, and it's not the pretty American actress facing us, but the rat nose of the gigantic spider, Inspector Lestrade. Wiggins, what are you doing here? Roars the gigantic Shelob-like beast. We're working on a heist for Mr. Holmes. Can we see Miss Longtree? Enter, orders Lestrade, skittering to the side. He slams the door behind us with four of his arms and leads us to the main room of Miss Longtree's suite. And why did you want to see her, exactly? We have a few questions for her about a diamond she has recently acquired. A diamond, huh? Can we see her? To see her, you'll have to go to St. Bart's, Wiggins. Miss Longtree was brought to the morgue. She was found dead a few hours ago! Dead? Murdered? What reason do you have to think that she was murdered? Asks Lestrade, while fixing Wiggins with his eight small black eyes. None! We simply came here about the diamond. We haven't found a diamond. Tell me everything, Wiggins! Wiggins grabs Lestrade by an elbow to a quieter corner of the room, away from the other policemen busy cleaning up webs. After a few words whispered in his ears, Lestrade's attitude changes entirely. Come this way. Lestrade heads to the room. Miss Longtree was found dead in her bathtub a few hours ago, her veins slit. The macabre vision of the bathwater tainted a pale pink, and the three crimson drops splattered on the white tiles around the bathtub attest to Lestrade's story. A suicide?
So it would seem. Strahd lights a cigarette, standing before the bathtub, his gaze lost in the water. But there's something odd. What do you mean? I just can't put my finger on it. We found the razor in the bathtub at the feet of the victim, folded. It's possible that she took the time to close the razor and toss it after slicing her veins, but that's pretty unusual. The murder examiner will surely be able to tell us more. Lestrade turns to the main room. Here's her jewelry box. No diamond here. I checked with the front desk. She had no valuable belongings in the hotel safe.
Inspector, I found something!
One of the police officers who was searching the room brings us a letter.
I found it under the mattress.
What?
The mattress!
Lestrade opens the letter. I suppose you are telling the truth, Wiggins. Tell His Royal Highness the next time he wishes to send a discreet message, to not do so on paper bearing his arms. It says, with a royal insignia of the Prince of Wales at the top, Dearest, I'm sending you this short message to let you know how much I appreciated our last meeting. That's the worst sext I've ever heard. To answer your question, no. As you know, my life is constantly being watched. You can always count on my friendship, but I have other duties which rule my life. I hope you understand. It's signed simply F.
Can I return this letter to the prince? Of course not, Wiggins. This is evidence.
He carefully puts the letter away in his notebook. Now let me do my work. Strahd continues his investigations by devouring a crying chambermaid. We listen from a discreet distance.
You discovered the body of Miss Langtree.
Yes, sir. It's terrible what happened to her, but I'm really not surprised.
Why is that?
The way she lived. She was with that nice Mr. Laws, but he ended up leaving. Since then, men came and went at all hours.
Interesting. Laws, you say?
Oh, Mr. Laws lived in the suite next to Miss Longtree's up until a few weeks ago. He claimed that he was a manager, but it was plain to see that it wasn't only his only task by her side.
Where did you see Mr. Laws for the last time?
The very day before your arrival. He was so shaken up after he left, stumbling, before the maitre d' even had time to stop him.
Ha! Huh, Wiggins, you're still here, exclaims Lestrade as he turns around.
I'm not really surprised. This wasn't Miss Longtree and Mr. Law's first misdeed together. They're the subject of many investigations in New York. I'd be curious to get my many, many hands on the man. And so would we, concludes Wiggins in a half-whisper.
So,
yes!
So did I hear... Oh, which one was it? This one?
Yes.
Okay, let's see. Okay, so he did show up. So he left a few weeks ago, but was last seen there just yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Anyone else want to look at anything from it?
No.
Okay. Well... Pinkertons might not be a bad place to hit if they've been watching their movements.
I don't think we've visited Pinkerton's office before.
Indeed.
Do you think you'll die if you read an entry? Be careful. One false move in front of the Pinkertons and they'll light you up.
Yeah.
They'll riddle you full of lead. The Pinkerton International office can be found at 24 Northwest.
24 Northwest. Oh.
Hmm.
We are investigating Longtree and Laws. Tell us about them? Asked Wiggins. Laws was implicated a few years ago for some shady business in New York. It seems that there are suggestions of his implication in a murder. As with all crooks, he has a charming side, but one which, in this case, hides a violent drunk.
Oh.
Have you ever met with him? We had him followed. He's renting a furnished apartment at 34 Macklin Street. Thank you for your information. Well.
Excellent.
That was a very efficient way to locate that.
It was.
Macklin.
I admit, my
primary impression of the Pinkertons is from Red Dead Redemption, and so I just think of them as bad guys.
Well, that would be a very interesting 2-hour discussion. We'll skip it.
Wasn't that who you were working for at the beginning of BioShock Infinite?
Surprise me the timing would match. I never played that one, but yeah.
Macklin, huh?
Yeah, I'll get this out of the way.
30. Oh no, I already forgot.
I see a bunch of 30s here. But no 34. Curious.
Yeah, 34.
There's a 34. Is there a Macklin next to it? I don't think so.
Where is? Unless it's on the East End thing. But nothing's been there since we flipped it.
32, 33. Boop.
London.
The Void.
Well, it's a very old city.
Yeah. That's fair.
One that's been rearranged by earthquakes many times over.
Still closed.
Oops, sorry. Did it say it was an apartment or like a hotel?
It sounded like he was renting a room.
Oh, okay. It's gotta be somewhere.
Does it?
Yeah.
There's a 34. Is there a Macklin next to it?
There's a Dresden, a Palace, and a Victoria.
All right, that's three districts eliminated.
So which district
happens? It's got to be here or here.
This 34 is located here. We've got Wimple. Cavendish, Square, New Bond Street, Windbeck
Street. Oh, I'm wrong. This one is in this district, so it must be here then.
39, 38. 37.
Is that a 54?
Yeah, it's a 54. Polo objects.
Polo. Find it. Use your nose.
Why don't you look on Google where Macklin Street in London is?
What?
Oh, there's a 34 right there.
Shoe Lane.
That's the one I keep finding, but it's...
But it's over there. Yeah, the other 34 is over here.
Yep.
Yes. Not near that. Oh, wait, here's a... Oh, there you go, Macklin, 34.
Excellent.
So it's in 34...
WC.
34 WC.
Yep.
Okay.
We're hot on the trail of a lawman. Laws. Of Steven Seagal lawman.
So 34 West Central.
Okay. Let's
see. You know, like, half that show is just him playing guitar?
For some reason, the only thing I think of when I think of Steven Seagal now is just that Fighterpedia bit of like, I like the Steven Seagal movie. I like you. Expect no mercy and pray for death.
Oh, man.
Other hyper-violent mountebanks.
There's like 2.5 minutes of fantastic Fighterpedia content, but it's bookended by just drivel. I like at least...
I don't know. Ode to Grapplers is like...
No, that's like one of the good ones.
Yeah.
I appreciate that Matt and Wooly just admitted, like, yeah, it was bad.
I think it was just like, it was too much effort for the amount of time, like, runtime it had compared to playing video games on the internet.
Yeah. More importantly, it introduced everyone to Zubaz. Yeah.
Alright. Yes. Mr. Laws resides here at the furnished apartment on the 3rd floor. Mrs. Emily Roster confirms to us as an answer to Wiggins' first question.
Organ heart.
What?
Is he here at the moment? No. Miss Roster is visibly a woman of few words, to Wiggins' great dismay. We absolutely have to find him, Miss Roster. Wiggins' smile, while unable to loosen Miss Roster's lips, seems to calm her down, however. I have something for him. Well, I hope it's money. He owes me 2 weeks' rent. If he didn't spend all of his money on drink, how much does he owe you? 35 shillings. Meanwhile, he's drinking all that his friend, that hussy, is giving him. Lily Longtree? Yes. I was to hand this to Mr. Laws, but maybe I should give it to you. Wiggins pulls out 2 sovereigns from his pocket. A smile finally lightens Miss Foster's face at the sight of the gold coins. Could we wait for him in his room? Of course, gentlemen. Miss Foster leads us along the corridor. She pulls out a key from her pocket and opens room number 6. She waits in front of the door for Wiggins to hand her the coins. She finally moves to let us enter the room. Wiggins closes the door behind us. All we have to do now is wait.
I know, that's my reaction to that being the last of it, too.
Wait, really?
Yeah.
There's not like a...
There's nothing at all.
No.
The only thing I can guess is that some other entry is going to say if you've if you've been to 34 West Central, go to this one.
Okay. All right. Well, suggest we're barking up the right tree.
Indeed. We're waiting here.
Yeah. Let's just put a pin in it. We can quick travel back here when necessary.
I wonder if there's a bar nearby.
Hey, that's a good thought. 34
Gray's
is...
Inn. The Lincoln's Inn. Wait, which 34 was it? I'm sorry, I got lost. Okay, so these two are nearby. Maybe the carriages could tell us which one he goes to if he takes a carriage.
Well, the implication seems to be that we're not going to find him until, like, you know...
Yes, that's so. I feel like we're going to trigger something that's like, if you found where this person is, then read this and then that or something. Okay, so what can we find out?
Where just the ending is going to be, and then Lincoln shot a dude again.
Well, there is one thing that's poking me, and it's why I kind of wanted to investigate where he drinks. So these two came to America recently. I mean, not came from America recently.
Yeah. Yep.
And yet somehow they had enough intel on the prince to get a hold of these letters. That seems a pretty big lift for someone new to the country.
That's fair, absolutely.
I feel like there's got to be somebody who helped them get that, or at least clued them in on it.
Sure.
Might this be where... Porky might be helpful?
Yes.
Quite possibly.
Porky Shinwell can, of course, be found at the Raven and Rat, 52 EC. Best place in London. Best place in London. Except for wherever it is that Holmes is juggling Scrabble letters.
52 EC, you said?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, why isn't Holmes doing this one? It's from the prince. Is he like...
He didn't seem too impressed with the prince, I mean.
I'll get to it at some point. Wiggins, you handle this one.
Oh, no, the final twist is going to be that it was, like, this guy in disguise as the prince the whole time.
Porky remains silent while Wiggins exposes our investigation to him. But in the end, he gives him a wink and says, "I think I can help you with this one." Porky scribbles a few words on a scrap of paper and slides it across the counter to Wiggins. On the paper is a name, Luke Paget, and an address, 51 Drummond Court. Who is he? An artist. And what's the link with our investigation? There are many kinds of artists. This one is specialized in the reproduction of jewels, and the rumor says that his last order was for a large diamond.
Interesting.
Yep.
So where was he at?
51 Drummond Court.
Okay.
It's another hunt and peck, I think.
Here's 51 seems to not be Drummond Court.
Here's a 51, and it also seems to not be where we're going.
So this north. 51 also does not appear to be.
We're getting better at this. We're good at map.
There's a 51. What was the street name?
There's Drummond Street. So then it ends in Drummond Court. There we go.
Okay.
A chicken in the kitchen is making all the sound. The cake is done while we're sitting around. what's center?
Yes.
51. Luke Padgett Studio,
is located in a narrow alleyway. The man behind the door doesn't want to let us in until we mention Holmes' name.
Yeah.
And slip him a pound under the door. We don't know which of these two exchanges granted us entry. The man who we suppose is Luke Paget is a short man of average age with fine brown hair and small eyes set too far away from his large crooked nose. He has large ears and slim lips. Maybe he is the goblin we were looking for earlier.
Maybe.
I think we've heard that you have a special, that you had a, I think I've heard that you had a special talent, says Wiggins.
That's right. I'm also allergic to mysteries. And I asked for a good payment for it. What interests you? A diamond, the Akbar Shah. What do you mean?
Oh, he started rapping. Got the cash and got the tools. Got the stolen jewels.
Who did you make it for? Paget lights a cigarette. He takes all of his time to answer us. What do I gain in answering you? How much were you paid to make a replica? Once again, what do I gain from answering you? What if I add a bill? Paget is amused by our offer. And what if you instead added about 100, my boy? Well, Wiggins grabs Paget by the back of his collar and lifts him up. And what if I didn't tell Scotland Yard about your little talents as a forger, my boy? Who hired you to make a copy of that diamond? Wiggins lifts Paget a bit more, who ends up standing on the tips of his toes. How do you expect me to know? You had an American accent and paid well. That's all that matters. It took me over a week to make the copy. A real goldsmith's work. No one would have been able to tell the real from the fake. I handed him the diamond this morning. That's all I know. This morning. Wiggins lets go of Paget, who crumbles to the ground. We leave the studio. Well, this just got a little more complicated. So there was a fake diamond.
When was the lady seen wearing the diamond?
The party, but when was it is a good question.
Yeah. Do you want to check? I can check the front.
Yeah, check the front.
Check the front.
Let's check the front.
Next. Turn page.
Library.
Lord Cantlemere, during Sir Everard Hancock's dinner. Whenever that was.
But Cantlemere's entry has when it was, maybe?
I don't remember it,
but we can check
it. I think we've spoken to...
Cantlemere? Yeah.
Oh, we spoke to Cantlemere, 55, yes. 55
Southwest. We haven't spoke to Everard Hancock.
55 where?
Southwest.
I'm the best at breathing.
It was at the dinner held in Sir Everard Hancock's residence. Doesn't actually say when. But in any case, if it was in the evening, then it was before this forgery was handed over.
Indeed.
Which, I could see the point in, well...
I'll just confirm, it said they handed in the diamond this morning.
Right? That's what I remember hearing.
Which is weird, because you'd think you'd need the real diamond in order to make forgery.
Unless it's a famous enough diamond that its appearance is well known.
To the library! Okay, well, alright, let's think about this for a second.
I'm more interested in the carriages again all of a sudden, because if this guy's been doing some interesting things this morning by the sound of it.
We could take a trip to the depot. 5WC.
We don't have to go yet, you were saying something?
No, I think that's... I was going to say, maybe we should pause for a second and think.
Yeah, we can do that.
About, like... Well, not even necessarily the timeline, but certainly the timeline factors in. Why would you need a forgery of the diamond if you've stolen the original diamond in the first place? Like, what's the point? Why show up?
You can't really... I mean, unless you just want the diamond, like...
Excuse me. That's exactly it. They steal the original diamond, hold it for ransom, turn over the fake diamond, then they have the diamond and the ransom money. Of course. Alright, problem solved. Yeah.
Indeed.
Okay. This seems smart, right? I'm a smart guy.
Yeah, I mean, that fits the pattern of the sort of things they've done in the past, blackmail and illicit behaviors and whatnot.
Yeah. Interestingly, though, they haven't actually issued demands for the diamond yet. They've just, well, now by making it public, that's implicit, I suppose.
I think so,
yeah, with
yes.
the Prince of Wales being involved, his obvious discomfort over the situation.
Sure. And then on the flip side of that, remember, someone had to have gotten the diamond out of the safe in the first place.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And someone would need to know about the letters.
The prints, yes.
And helping with that. Which I still don't think two Americans could pull off 1 week after coming to Europe.
Right.
And it's like, well, they say that, I mean, I guess, like, we know it's the work of a professional, and this guy does seem to be a career criminal, but that still doesn't, like...
That's a heck of a thing to be able to dig out and make a plan around in a week and a half.
Yeah.
That's the part I'm tripping over. I mean, if it was a couple of months, okay, fine. But, or if it was known well in advance that he was going to end up with the diamond, it was an auction, and it sounded like it was big news that he bought the diamond. It wasn't something...
And then on top of that, it appears that there was some kind of a falling out between the two Americans. And one of them is now dead. I'd completely forgotten about that. We have a corpse we can investigate.
Mm-hmm. Falling out is one theory, but he left that morning looking shaken and unhappy.
Maybe he found her dead.
Yeah, the falling out may not have been serious enough for him to have been the murderer, I guess is what I'm saying.
Oh, certainly. I'm not saying that he's guilty of the murder, but there is a dead body, and we can talk to people about that.
Oh, yes.
Perhaps... Oh, we should. I was going to rap, but I couldn't think of anything that rhymes with should.
Well, there's the carriage company, there are the dead body peoples, which there are two good ones for that. The forensics. In St. Bart's.
I'm of the mind that perhaps the body is worth investigating.
Okay.
Sir Jasper Meeks can be found at 38 EC.
Okay.
I believe it's a Herbie turn.
Me too. 38 EC?
Indeed. Remember when Polo was sitting on my lap? That was pretty good. Oh, Polo remembers too.
Okay, here we go. I can tell you this, Wiggins. Miss Longtree was dead long before her wrists were slit.
Oh!
That's why there was so little blood. You see these two marks in the back of her neck? They were made by the thumbs of someone who came in from behind and strangled her.
Oh. That's it?
That's it.
That's still pretty good.
Yeah, it's interesting information. Strangled from behind.
Yeah.
Behind. Okay.
Polo.
So it could have been, I mean, it's possible that if he did it, that he just got drunk and violent and strangled her, and he shook up because he didn't actually want to kill his partner.
But if he was drunk, would he have enough forethought and, frankly, manual dexterity to put her in the tub, slit her wrists, and...
Maybe he came back and did that afterwards.
That's possible. After all, it was a long time, so he...
And then he'd still be, like... what I'm getting at is he can be both guilty and shook up about it.
Yeah, that would fit. He kills her the night before or something in a drunken rage. He wakes up in the morning's like, oh, crap.
Right.
He goes back, does the stuff, takes the diamond, and...
Gets going.
And now he has both diamonds.
Let's follow up with Murray to see if he's got anything for us.
Okay.
22 Southwest.
Okay. Murray. 22.
The doors to Murray's laboratory are closed, and no one answers our knocks on the door.
I'm
just kidding.
You know, in second thoughts, I should have realized that, because if she was found in the bathtub, then she wouldn't have anything in her pockets.
Well, there was the razor.
True.
There was at least one piece of evidence that could have learned more about.
Okay. Well.
Carriages.
The Central Carriage Depot could be found at 5 West Central.
Okay. Carriage.
Sorry, I'm distracted by this.
No, you're fine. That's actually a giant crocodile.
Awesome. Yeah.
Yes. My wizard can polymorph into him.
Yep. We also found one that vapes. He was a bad guy.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
As was clear to almost everyone in the party.
It was clear to everyone except the person who swore an oath to serve him.
We're told about a round trip between Northumberland Avenue and Blackfriars Road early this morning.
A guy with a mean look and a strong foreign accent, the driver informs us.
American? Asks Wiggins.
No. But not from over here, you know.
Hmm. And where were the locations?
Northumberland Avenue and Blackfriars Road.
And it was this morning.
Yes. So let's see if either of those locations are near Drummond Court.
Great, so we've got...
I wonder, where's the Grand Hotel?
We have a new accent.
Ah, yes, we do.
I wonder if this character is related to the main plot or a side story.
Yes. Yes. Drummond Court is here, is that right?
Yep. This is a case where I will, in fact...
Northumberland. Oh, here's Northumberland Avenue.
Oh, excellent.
I don't know if we can hold a crocodile or something on that.
Sure. Here's a demon.
Alright.
Okay. And Blackfriars Road was the other one?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to Google that, I think. We have no other way of easily connecting. That could be anywhere.
Well, presumably it's in London.
Yeah.
Let's see where it is in relation to the Thames. Somewhere.
Blackfriars Road.
There you go. Yeah. See?
Yeah.
It's not so hard.
Okay, so that Blackfriars Road is pretty long. What section is that? I can't see.
Southeast.
Southeast. Well, things that are in southeast that we've been to are zero. We've been nowhere in the southeast.
Mm.
And this is West Central?
Yes, I guess
so. No, this is around the Grand Hotel.
Okay, so it's around the Grand Hotel 22 West Central. That definitely fits. So, somewhere here.
How have I never noticed the South London Palace of Amusements? Oh my god, we are absolutely going to check that out. Come along, boys! We're going to the circus!
You want to
ask? Oh, there's not an entry for that. Mm-hmm. Sorry, everyone. What about the Elephant and Castle Theater? Mm. That's an actual circus! With, like, knights!
Blackfriars Road. So I guess what we should just remember is we're looking for something on Blackfriars Road and keep an eye out for it.
Probably so, yes. Okay. Well.
It's another foreigner.
I wonder. Yeah, can I see the paper? I wonder if there's anything that would stand out. Probably not the child stolen by the monkey.
Perhaps the monkey has continued its lascivious ways. Okay, well, remaining leads that we haven't investigated. We've got the two friends.
We could go to the party.
We could go to the party?
Oh, the guy who held the party.
The guy who held the party,
find out
yes.
When the party was.
Yes, exactly.
A surprisingly elusive piece of information.
Yes.
Oh, there was a paper sooner than the 19th. There was one on the 24th.
But it's only half a paper.
Oh, indeed it is. Not much of a paper. Sadnesses.
Okay. Well, let's speak to...
That might be the one I'm looking for. Thank you.
Mr. Everett.
Okay.
Brandon, sound good to you?
Yeah.
Do you have the spelling of this man's name written down somewhere, Herbie?
I have my best guess at it. All right. I thought his last name was Hancock, though.
Yeah, there, yeah, that's there we go. That's what I'm looking for. That's the money. That's the nail in the coffin. That's the way the cookie crumbled. 74 Southwest is where we're going.
Yes.
That is definitely what she said.
Lily Longtree was present during that dinner, says Sir Everard in response to our first question. Why was she invited? She wasn't invited. She was accompanying Hale Brogham and his gang from the Cavendish Card Club. Hale Bowman? Broham? Broham.
That definitely sounds like a bad guy. He sounds like the recurring...
Last parties.
Yeah, he definitely sounds like the recurring rival character that keeps interfering with your cowboys.
See, 74 Southwest?
Yes.
Okay, I'm sorry. Yeah, let me read it when you're done.
And the Cavendish card.
I have no hope at those names without...
Brougham.
That sounds reasonable.
I think the Cavendish Card Club is our next destination.
I have very good news here.
Yes?
Sterling's Royal Remedy is a positive cure guaranteed for the most dreadful of diseases,
thank goodness. Syphilis. Oh. Yeah, good.
But even that won't save you from a fatal encounter with a shark.
Did you know that during this time period, there was a doctor who, this is a true story, this was a guy who was a doctor with quote marks around, who was trying to prove that syphilis and gonorrhea were the same disease, just like if one was an evolved state of the other, and he exactly. Only he wanted he needed like a control subject in order to do that, and he needed someone that had never been infected with either of those things, which in London at this time period was very difficult to come by. But he had never, so he infected himself. Only, unfortunately, the science came along in a couple of years to show, no, they're definitely different things. You just infected yourself with syphilis and gonorrhea, to be wrong.
Well,
hello.
That's science.
The Cavendish Club can be found at 25 Northwest.
Okay.
Should I grab that?
Absolutely.
Yes, that was like two. That was
grab
two
away.
Left. So it was one Northwest?
25.
25.
Northwest. Okay.
Alright. The doorman lets us into a foyer dominated by a large bronze horse head. La Selle Vide, a memorial dedicated to the cavaliers fallen during their service. We step closer to the gaming tables. How do you do, fellow gamers?
Hey guys.
How may I be of use, gentlemen? Asked a man who appears to be the manager. Mr. Wickham. You might not remember me.
Mr. Wickham.
Wickham, I guess. Says Williams as he extends his hand. We met a few years ago in the case of Ronald Adair's disappearance.
Never mind.
Yes, of course. I had only been here for a few months at the time, but I was very shocked by Cornel Moran's behavior.
I remember that case.
Yeah.
It's hard to remember, forget that name.
He had been my guest here on many occasions. Is Mr. Brougham, how would we decide that was pronounced?
Just make something up, but make sure it's different every single time.
Pass by here often? He regularly visits the club when he's in London. Yeah, he has been here frequently these last few weeks, and dined in the company of Mr. Delechus, a Frenchman, I believe, Mr. Pemberton, the politician, and Mr. Noonan from the Pall Mall Gazette. Do you know where we can find them?
Did you say delicious? Do you mean Delacroix?
I thought you meant deli. I thought you said Delechus.
Delicious.
Oh my God! It is delicious. It's just the Swedish spelling.
This is delicious. He's renting a furnished apartment at 85 Blackfriars Road.
Oh, motherfucker. That's how you pronounce that
name.
Yeah,
he's the Frenchman, so he's the only one with an accent.
Ooh,
as well.
Oh. Hey, how would a cabbie not know a Frenchman's accent, though? That's crazy. Well, maybe he's got syphilis in the ears. I mean,
so it says this is Deli Shoes is at 85. What?
What was the second man's name? Pemberton.
Pemberton, the politician.
Pemberton, the politician. Thanks, Mom.
The others are in the phone book. Now, if you could excuse me, I have work in the kitchen.
Well, we already know which one.
I have to crack this egg into the bowl.
I think it's
clear
what our next destination must be.
We have to go kill us a Frenchie. Well, Wiggins does.
Yeah.
And then claim it was an accident.
I've been shown who is the boss!
And he was at 85, where is it?
Southeast.
Southeast, yes. 85 Southeast.
Okay. Will not release your arm until you say, I love Crips. Do you remember that night where we were watching the bonus scenes from that in my old place in Orlando? There was like 8 of us stuffed in that little tiny place. And they were recording a commercial about the fact that wild dogs had taken over most of America's cities.
Wild pullos. Alright. No one answers Wiggins' knocks on the door. He pulls out his lockpick, inserts it in the cheap lock, and opens it quickly. The room is a mess.
Oh, I guess Luke's out of a job.
Yeah. The room is a mess, a real bohemian paradise. Books are scattered around, obviously fallen from a homemade shelf, unable to support the tomes that were stacked up on it. A large, unmade bed is located against the wall, above which hang 2 portraits of bushy-bearded men with feverish eyes who seem to observe us. Bakunin and Marx, says Wiggins as he looks at the 2 revolutionaries. The sort of images usually found in socialist parties and unions. Wiggins picks up a few of the scattered books. The Paris Commune and the Idea of the State by Bakunin. Dark Horizon by Andreyev. Salute to Free Humanity by Gorky. A very targeted type of literature. We inspect the rest of the room. There's a small chimney filled with still warm ashes. It looks like papers were burned here. The drawers are empty, says Wiggins. He then heads to a small desk and opens one of its drawers. Here's something promising. He comes closer and sees an envelope that Wiggins has pulled out from the bottom of the drawer. This letter must have been missed during his great cleaning. Serbia. And there is indeed a letter addressed to Nikola Pastich at 85 Blackfriars Road, London, Southeast. Dear Nikola, I'm writing to you in English in case the Black Hand intercepts this letter. Why make their lives
easier? The orcs!
Why make their lives easier? How far along are you with the plan? We'll need you shortly. Things are in motion. The king and his father are in disagreement. It's time to strike.
Well, that's certainly interesting.
It is.
So, as I understand it, the king of England is dead, so he can't be talking about here.
No, I don't think so.
Yeah.
Is this related to all the international intrigue that has been on the
paper?
It's maybe time to start looking at that, because that stuff goes back as far as the very first paper.
Yes, indeed.
Do I need to grab one of those?
Sure.
It wouldn't be a bad idea. Here, have at it.
In consequence of the Pan-Servian troubles which have been growing in Macedonia, the authorities of Monsater are taking steps to close all of the Servian schools in the district. They allege that there is no real need for these schools, that they eke out an artificial existence owed merely by the support given to them by the St. Sava Association in Belgrade. Serbian government protests against this view, but it is borne out by an inflammatory pamphlet just issued by Mr. Tchumich, the newly appointed Serbian minister in Athens. Mr. Tchumich declares in excited language that the Bulgarians are the most formidable enemies of the Serbian race. He exhorts all the patriotic associations existing in Serbia to devote their funds to the creation of schools in Macedonia. Da-da-da-da-da-da. Yes. Trouble. Here is a article in the same paper, which is the Pall Mall, I'll point out, which seems to be a supportive argument for the labor movement related to socialism on the whole, by one Gilbert Noonan.
So, I guess that explains why those people were meeting together.
It's true.
Definitely. What the blazes does all of it have to do with the diamond theft?
It might not.
Yeah, it might not.
It might not.
Might not. I think it would still be worth trying to. Did he say at all where Hale Brugem was staying? He said he frequents the club when he's in town from out of town. And he's been here for a few weeks. Did it actually say where he lives here in the city?
Wait, is that not where he went?
No, we went to the club where he hangs out.
And then we went to Deli Shoes.
Oh, Deli Shoes. Oh, yes. Oh, which other character is that?
The first guy that we were following. Brouhaha,
oh, yeah.
Who escorted the lady to the party.
Yes, right. Yeah, we didn't actually look up. Yes.
But did it even say? Did it even suggest?
No, I think we'd have to look that up ourselves.
Or find it by talking to one of the other two people.
Ah, just so. Very good, very good. We might well need to do exactly that. In which case...
I'd have to go back and look.
Well, there was a politician, and then, of course, there was Noonan himself.
Yes. Well, I think we should speak to Noonan.
Okay.
Oh.
Yes?
I found out where Lily Longtree performs, but it's kind of not really relevant at this point.
That's true. She's dead.
Where did she perform?
In her grand show of lyrical theater every evening at 8 at the Covent Garden Theater?
Yes.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah. Might be worth remembering if we completely run out of things to look at.
The backhandiest of compliments. Well done, Brandon.
I didn't mean it that way. I mean, as you said yourself, we're already kind of past it, potentially.
That's about my assessment of it as well.
But if, you know, if we run out of other stuff, we might get something useful from who she was seen there with or who came to visit or something.
That is so. It might be another place where they would tell us about Hale Brugham.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why don't we speak to Mr. Noonan in the hopes that he can tell us where to find Mr.
Is Brougham not in there?
No, well, Brougham doesn't live in London. They said that.
Yeah.
But I think we need to find one of these other guys and shake him down, Wiggins style. Mm-hmm. Gilbert Noonan can be found at 73 Northwest.
Okay.
Mm. Hello.
Yeah, although I get the feeling that's going to lead down the side path.
Well, but he was at the party.
Was he at the party? I thought he was at the club.
No, he
the gang. They said he was there with the gang from the Cavendish
Club.
But the entire reason we're trying to find him is that he escorted her to the party where she was seen with the diamond.
Right. Yeah.
Right. Well, or Brougham was.
Well, I was.
We don't know.
It is your turn.
Oh, okay. But I just read a pretty good-sized entry about socialism and Karl Marx.
Yeah. Oh, excuse me. I forgot all about it.
Yeah.
I was so excited.
I love reading. Don't get me wrong.
I love reading. What did I tell you the address was?
73 Northwest.
Excellent. I will go there. You stay home.
Okay.
73 Northwest. No one answers our knocks at Gilbert Noonan's property.
Maybe we should go to his newspaper instead.
We go around the house and find the back door open. No. Our calls remain unanswered, and we see no sign of life. As we enter the smoking room, which the heavy curtains have plunged into darkness, we see the silhouette of a man sitting behind a desk. Mr. Noonan, Wiggins calls out, holding up his gun in hopes. No answer. Wiggins shoots a switch near the door, turning the lights on. Noonan won't answer us, or anyone else, ever again. He's dead. From a gunshot to the head. His eyes are wide open, as if they were looking at the papers on his desk. Wiggins reads a handwritten note sitting atop. Dear Arnold, my will is, as you well know, in order. Thank you for having been my friend. I hope you'll be able to take care of my wishes after my departure. If I can't bring justice for others, I can at least do so for my own actions. May God forgive me. Your devoted, Gilbert.
Okay.
Well, certainly a little more interest in talking to the last member of this club.
I am that also, yes. Finding out what his will says might also be worthwhile.
This is a savage club.
I just can't believe how savage this club is. The last man, Pemberton, the politician, can be found at 73 EC.
Hopefully he's not also dead.
What was the name? Arnold. Arnold.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
73 EC?
73 EC.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The pavement in front of Marvin Pemberton's door is packed full of people. All members of the Manchester Socialist Party. Most are workers, dock workers, carpenters, and brewers, the spine of the party. They came to ask for support for their strikes and changes to the law. And Pemberton, the man of the people, is there to help them. It takes us 20 minutes before we are in front of Pemberton's secretary. What can I do for you? Says the secretary, overwhelmed behind the desk. We'd like to see Mr. Pemberton. On what subject? Well, we need to talk to him. Could he give us a few moments? I might be able to find a spot early next week. Do you want to make an appointment? Don't you have any space today? No, I'm sorry. Well, then, too bad. No appointment. Thank you. How many Arnolds are there?
Well, as a matter of fact, I had a thought.
Yes.
Which is, this is seemingly a note for someone to take care of his will, right?
Yeah.
Which means that maybe Arnold was his lawyer.
Oh, well, that's possible.
Which, in fact, there is only one solicitor with the first name Arnold.
Ooh. Uh-huh. Okay, let's go see him.
8 Northwest is Arnold Sutro's address.
Should I just go ahead and grab that?
Yeah, absolutely.
8
Hope he's not a socialist.
8 what? Sorry.
Northwest.
Okay.
All right. Yes, I'm Gilbert Noonan's lawyer.
Ha!
Don't tell me he's been arrested for libel again.
No.
Haven't you heard the news? What news? I'm deeply sorry, but Mr. Noonan's dead. It appears that he committed suicide. Gilbert! Suicide? I don't understand. Mr. Sutro, I'm sorry. I need to go immediately to see if there's anything I can do. What? Well, he said Mr. Sutro ... Well, no, we said that.
Yes.
Oh.
What are you thinking?
I was hoping a ... we could potentially fill in the rest of that.
No, that's his name.
That's his name.
Yeah.
That's not for us.
No.
Well.
Well.
We have this bizarre intrigue that doesn't seem to be going anywhere.
Not yet. Maybe we have to go to the underworld, like Orpheus. And interrogate him there. Still no closer to this Brugham. Indeed. This bugbear.
Indeed.
Also, so we went to Delicious. We found a note that was written to someone else. Or that's his alias.
Oh, I thought that was to him. Excuse me.
Okay, it was.
What was his address?
Which guy's address?
Delicious.
85 Southeast.
85 Southeast, yes.
Because it was like, it sounded like it was someone who may have been serving.
So Somerset House has wills.
Nicola. Yes. Excuse me. Nicola Pasich?
Yeah. So I was wondering if we either A, could find out where that guy actually lives. B, oh, it says where he lives right there. Oh, so it's here.
Yeah, that's right here. Yeah, I think he was the same guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that may have been his alias.
Still worth knowing his name.
He may have been accounted for by an ambiguously foreign accent.
Right.
Yeah.
If he is a person from Serbia pretending to be French.
So we're saying he took a hotel to the Grand... Excuse me, he took a carriage to the Grand Hotel.
Yep.
This morning.
Yep.
Yeah.
Why?
Nothing good, probably.
To get the diamond?
And or to... commit a murder.
Maybe. Hi, Polo. Polo doesn't like murder.
Hi, Polo.
Okay.
Yeah, or to carry out some political act that remains ambiguous.
Yes. A lot of pieces.
Indeed. Well, I mean, Somerset House would have his will on file.
Oh, yes. Let's do that.
Okay.
Where can Somerset House be found?
The Somerset House is at 17 West Central.
Hello. Hello.
I don't really see how I could give you information about American citizens, the employee from Somerset House tells us, perplexed. That's not why we were there. You specifically mentioned a will, and it was not of an American citizen.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. But understandable.
Excuse me. Okay, well.
Just like, crazy that there's like another murder and...
All right, now let's
potentially suicide.
Let's think about this.
All right,
we've got a group of socialist activists who have ties to the revolution in Serbia. Mm-hmm. So they know about the diamond and come up with this plan. They have someone on the inside that can help them get a hold of the diamond. They enlist the aid of these known American blackmail artists.
They may even have enlisted the aid of them from when they were in America and actually had them brought over for it. Yeah.
Yeah. They get their hands on the diamond, but there's some kind of a falling out. She gets killed. Laws splits town or disappears.
Or we're waiting for him to come home.
Oh, that's right. We are waiting for him to come home.
Indeed.
Can I see, I'd like to see the entry for the club again. What was that number?
The
25
Northwest.
Yeah.
Cavendish Club. Okay, well, let me sort out the 1888 papers since they're never going to, or almost certainly not going to be that relevant. It's 1888. This is not 1888.
Yeah, because at first I was imagining this is going to be one of those cases where, like, oh, Holmes solved it in four leads, and, like, all of this is irrelevant. But no, she very clearly went there with this group.
Yeah.
And it's possible that that was coincidental, but it seems...
Well, given the unfortunate fates that seem to be surrounding members of this group, it's it'd be hard to convince me that it has nothing to do with anything.
Yeah. We have no idea where, you know, Dilly Shoes even is. Even if he's real.
Although. No. Who's our agent for course? I think it's under all your.
Oh yes.
Materials.
Foreign stuff. That's
yes.
Henry Ellis.
Henry Ellis. I think he'd be worth talking to. Maybe you give us a little bit better information about this society.
What is he at?
Henry Ellis can be found at the London Times, 30 EC. Is it whose turn is it?
I think
it's
mine.
I think it is a Harvey turn.
Yep.
Take it away.
Okay.
From Brandon, who has it.
Oh. 30 EC.
Hold the phone. Now give me the phone.
Do we actually have an idea who the Black Hand in question
is? Yes, the Black Hand is the name of a revolutionary group, most notably known for assassinating Duke Franz Ferdinand and starting World War I in Serbia.
Right.
Yep.
Okay. Did you know that Nikola Pastiche is supposed to be in London at this moment, Wiggins? Henry Ellis answers us. Pastiche? Ah, there you go. You're finally interested in the politics of in the Balkans, continues Ellis, happy to have brought our attention to one of the topics of the hour. Pastiche is a Serbian revolutionary whose dream is the formation of a united, free, and democratic Slovakian state, and he's willing to kill to bring that dream to life. I think the Russians would love to get their hands on him.
So who is that?
That was talking about Nicola Pastich, the guy who was
Right. No, but who was that we were talking to then?
The reporter,
Ellis. Hmm.
So he's definitely a killy-killy kind of person.
A killy-killy kind of person, absolutely.
Also says the Russians might have some information on him. Russian embassy, maybe.
I was thinking that.
Yeah, if there's not one for Serbia, then definitely.
Yeah, why not? Herbie, would you like to take this one as well?
Oh, sure, yeah. Where are we going?
It's 54 Southwest.
Okay.
Take us to Zangief Town.
54 Southwest. Okay, let me just finish my notes.
Do you have something you'd like to share with the room?
I'm just thinking about real Soviet damage.
Yeah, that's fair. I'm trying to remember the lyrics to Red Cyclone.
54 Southwest. Cool, alright. We're led into a small office in the back of the embassy where an imposing one-eyed and one-armed man strapped into a general's uniform greets us. He says nothing while Wiggins explains the reasons for our visit. Oh boy. What is the name of this person you're looking for? Asked General. I'd like to take a moment to apologize to the Russian people for the horrible butchering I'm about to do of this 32-character name. Ovosvyankyo Kulitio Viski.
Oh yeah, Olo.
Yeah, for the rest of this, I'm just going to call him the General, even if it actually types out that 32-character name again.
All right.
Pastich. Nicola Pastich, declares Wiggins. Pastich. This name is familiar to me. The General moves closer to the files covering one of the office's walls. He gazes over the files until he finds the one that interests him. He brings it to his desk and starts leafing through it. Yes, we've gathered much information on Pastich. He's a member of the Death's Union, an anarchist group devoted to the destruction of the great monarchies of this world. An anarchist? You mean a bomb layer? Yes. How do you think I lost this?
He shakes his empty left sleeve.
I was with the Tsar when those dogs tried to blow him up. Do you think that Pastich is here to make an attempt on the Queen's life? Who can say? They are a bit more, how should I say, sophisticated now. They learn to use political weapons.
Yeah.
You British have given them a formidable weapon, the vote. Soon, the populace will lead this country, the lowest common denominator. This would never happen in Russia. The Tsar would stand against the masses and win. It's clear that the General is no longer really talking to us. Thus, we leave the area as discreetly as possible while thanking him for his information.
Well, it's a good thing nothing bad will ever happen to the Tsar.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, that certainly gives a motive to this whole diamond thing.
Yes, it certainly does. Okay.
And by the way, if you want to see the name that I had,
oh,
ridiculous trouble.
Oh, yeah, it's
been
a hyphen.
That's I have no idea if I came within even a mile of it.
Ovzyaniko Kulikovsky.
That's a lot better than I did. I'll quite happily admit.
Far more interesting is Death's Union.
Indeed.
Oh my god.
Man.
And the fact that they've switched to subtle means.
Hmm.
Honestly.
Yeah.
I mean, the only thing that we're missing, I think, at this point, is how they got into the safe.
Yes.
Cantlemere or Sala. Seems like one of them would have to have given them the combination or have been careless in some way that allowed it to get out.
Either that, or just the entire reason they brought both the Americans on is one of them is a professional, like, thief, and the other is a...
I feel like we would have heard about that.
Yeah, the only issue I have with that is that we've gotten long laundry lists of the horrible things they've done, but it's always been blackmail-y, extortion-y, or killy-killy violence.
Yeah.
Besides which, if one of them is a drunk, I don't think that,
That would be the sneaky one.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out what his role in this is, though, if he didn't, steal diamonds or papers or whatever.
It's probably just protection for her, right?
Well, it could even be as simple as, they needed a woman to make the discrediting the monarchy thing work, potentially.
Right.
And he's her associate. You
perhaps came with her just because they've been working together.
Oh, did we confirm that the person who was talking to them... I wonder if they were involved and...
Who was?
Sorry, I didn't... Hang on. Regathering thoughts.
Okay.
I'm wondering if Mr. Law's role in all of this was just trying to get the forgery made of the diamond for his own benefit, so he could double-cross the anarchists.
Possible.
Maybe not even double-cross, but just to benefit from...
Well, yeah. Or, well, he wasn't going to let them have the real diamond in the end.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. Okay.
That is, purely speculation there, but...
Quite right. What's the Savage Club's address again?
The Savage Club is at 92 West Central.
I believe the counterfeiter talked to someone with an American accent.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm convinced Laws was the one who saw him.
Whereas the ambiguously foreign accent most likely belongs to this guy.
Yeah, we've been told pretty much straight up is probably very willing to kill if it meets his purposes.
Oh, yeah.
And is also very likely took a carriage from his apartment to where
the hotel
lady was murdered. Yeah.
Which was then, puts him... So he may have actually done the strangling, and then the other guy just discovered it and was like, gas. I gotta get out of town.
Yeah, actually, other guy probably did this... that's his M.O. He makes them look like suicides.
Yeah.
So that actually puts him on the hook for both, probably. And he's, he's an old hand at this stuff.
Yep.
So he killed them. He kills them both. He had a political motive for doing the whole thing in the first place. I feel like, based on the content of the letter that we did find, it's probably actually... It may actually be one of those two women that were mentioned that ends up being the person the letters were stolen from.
Why don't we speak to them, then?
Okay.
Bernhardt, I think, is one of them?
Yes.
Yes, Sarah Bernhardt.
Seems familiar.
Bernhardt. How was that spelled?
B-E-R-N, I think.
I have it here somewhere.
Bernhardt, Sarah, at 3 Southwest.
3 Southwest.
Okay.
Hope she's not murdered.
Yeah.
Sarah Bernhardt's beauty has not dimmed with time. Barely in her 50s, she's still one of the most beautiful and most gracious women in London. She insists on inviting us in for tea. Sound of Piccadilly Circus is dimmed to a simple whisper from atop the 4th floor of Miss Bernhardt's coquettishly decorated apartment, and we no longer pay any attention to it when our conversation with our hostess begins. Her voice, deep but pleasant, is colored by a slight French accent. His Royal Highness is a long-time friend, a good friend, but not in the way the press implied he was. Freddy doesn't have many real friends. He has duties to many people, and any number of parasites who cling to him. And which category is Lily Longtree in? You get straight to the point, Mr. Wiggins. I apologize. It's nothing. Freddy needs someone who knows how to ask questions in a direct manner. In his position, he can't allow himself to speak in person. Freddy doesn't even know that woman. I don't know what she's playing at. She probably seeks notoriety and recognition. Have you ever seen her perform, Mr. Wiggins? I haven't had the pleasure. I have, and this woman has no talent. She's nothing more than an immodest coquette. I see. And that's it.
Maybe the other woman actually will work better, because I remembered after we selected this one that it mentioned they hadn't actually spoken in a while.
Yes. What's her name? Kepner. That should be easier to find.
Kepner, yeah. Which makes her a much more likely target for that letter.
Kepner. There's a Kepner Oliver at 50... 8BC, that is Emily Kepner, I see.
Well, she may have married after,
A woman married to a man!
So where was it at?
56EC. I bet I said 8. I'm wrong.
I consented to speak with you only because you claim to work for the Prince. Thank you for the audience. Letters written by His Royal Highness have fallen into the wrong hands. Do you know anything about these missing letters? Papers were stolen from me a little over a month ago. It was right after having received a curious visit from a man with a foreign accent. But nothing of value was taken, and I therefore didn't file a complaint.
Well,
that checks. That tracks.
Indeed. And so literally the only thing I feel like we don't know at this point
is... how did they get in the safe?
Yeah, who got them in the safe? So way back at the Savage Club, they mentioned a reception or something that they were stolen?
Yes. Apparently there was a reception going on. Cantlemere was with them all evening.
Doesn't mean he didn't give the combination to somebody else.
How can we learn more about this Cantlemere fellow? He was in the military. Mm-hmm. Mycroft. Mycroft would probably know. Mycroft knows everything.
Government and politics?
It's true.
Well, it's not as unrelated as it usually is by the time you suggest him.
Mycroft can, of course, be found at 8 Southwest.
8.
He ate the Southwest. He accidentally the whole book.
Yes, Wiggins, I'm aware of the case on which you and Sherlock are working. Our future king has once again been caught red-handed. It seems that a diamond has been stolen, and a virtuous Englishman would have had no trouble letting it be known and reclaiming his jewel with the full power of the King of England and morality at his side. So then why does His Highness hide at St. James Palace in a most suspicious silence? Asked Mycroft, pulling his nose up from his paperwork for the first time. Appearances are against him, and there are elements to take into consideration. Mycroft lets escape. Who sows the wind reaps the tempest. So you think that His Highness had given the diamond to Lily Laundry? Oh, I didn't say that. I think, as the Queen does, that the Prince will look like an idiot no matter what he says. If he accuses her of theft, he'll be the court's laughingstock. Maybe even all of London's. If he does nothing, the people will think that it's adultery and that the Prince is as flighty with women as he is with the kingdom's money, and thus not worthy of the crown. Mr. Holmes, it's no secret that the Queen has been waiting to advocate for many years, but hasn't done so yet because of her son. He'll soon be 60, born to be king, but living the worry-free life of a buffoon. He's been kept under close watch these past few years.
A lot of interesting stuff there, but I'm not sure how helpful much of it is.
Yeah, too bad.
Indeed. Cantlemere. So if Cantlemere is the treasurer, Sala is the manager of the club.
Yep.
And all of our various checks, almost no one else has mentioned Cantlemere.
Yep.
And he was with them the whole time.
Yeah, I still think, I mean, he could have given the combination to anyone, and it's a combination safe. He doesn't need to be there for that. Just a matter of would he have a motive? Is he also?
Do we confirm his combination safe anywhere?
It said so in the
Review 92 West Central, because that feels like it's important if we're trying to figure out what we're doing. Why was the diamond at the club? You see, the prince, as a great friend to the arts, had loaned us the diamond for an exhibition. It was only supposed to last a few weeks. Other than you, who knows the combination? Only
you're right there. Yeah. There they say it.
Work of an experienced professional. No way of opening the safe with the key, no trace of tampering. This is the work of an experienced professional.
Or someone, so it's either someone with the combination or some great safe cracker.
Which, for all that our socialist fellow is an experienced murderer, he may not necessarily be an experienced safe cracker. It's a very different skill set.
No, I feel like we would have found more or been led a little bit more. Yes.
A month ago. What's the paper? I think there's a paper literally from September 1st in here, which would be... No?
It's stolen!
There's more over there.
Yeah, I think these are all the 88 ones, but I'll double check it. It's kind of annoying that they're mostly in September as well, because that made it hard. But yeah, there is a
The season for murder.
There is a September 1st, 1888, but that doesn't help us. The earliest you can go back and find one
from our current collection is the 13th of September, which doesn't really help us any. That should be the last mystery.
Yes, this is the last one.
Well,
let's read it anyway.
You made fun of me for saying it earlier, but then we could check the theater. Though I don't know how that's going to help us too much. It'll tell us... Well, we never did find what's-his-name.
Yeah, Hogsmeade.
Yeah. Broham.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, Haley Bopp. The Convent Garden Theater can be found at 30 WC.
Okay. Covent Garden at 30 WC.
Oh, excuse me.
Wigan shows us around the Covent Garden Theater. I played here last season. The doorman must remember me. Sydney does actually remember Wiggins and invites us for tea in his little office near the stage. Once they have reminisced, we begin talking about Lily Longtree. Damned American! Archie, bring me this. Archie, do that. Everyone must be at her beck and call. She doesn't have half the talent of Camille Clifford, but no British woman worthy of the name would behave like she did. It's not her talent which brings the crowd, but rather the physical graces God gave her, if you know what I mean. I think I know. I heard a rumor saying that she was very close to the Prince of Wales. Is that true? The old bandit, he should be careful. Have you seen them together? I saw his carriage, a nice brougham. She makes no secret of their nighttime dinners. The old fox. Is Miss Longtree here? No, she shows up half an hour before going on stage. She's at the Grand Hotel. You'll probably find her there.
Huh.
Well, what that sounds like to me is that she's... No, he saw the carriage. He didn't see the prince.
No, he saw the royal carriage, though.
He saw a nice brougham.
Oh, I thought it said...
Well, it said, I saw his carriage, a nice brougham, but he may have been assuming that a nice brougham was the prince's carriage.
That's fair.
And, of course, it would suit her purpose as well to be seen being taken about town, in a fancy carriage.
Which is odd, because we didn't get that from the, when we talked to the people's carriages, we didn't really get any info about...
Well, they were on the public ones, I think, right? If there was a private one...
Oh, no, you're right.
Wouldn't necessarily...
Well, let's investigate that.
Wait, investigate which?
The Royal Palace.
Oh, yeah, we can go there.
St. James Palace can be found at 6 Southwest. Thanks, Mycroft.
6 Southwest.
Or excuse me, it's not the Royal Palace. Oh, it is a Royal Palace. It is not necessarily the Royal Palace. There are many Royal Palaces. We cross the yard between St. James's Palace and Marlborough House, the residence of the Prince of Wales, when he's in London. We're met outside the entrance hall by a Scottish soldier in a Highlands uniform. Once inside the entrance hall, we're handed off to two powdered footmen dressed all in red, who hand our hats and overcoats to a domestic. The porters turn to a page wearing a deep blue coat and a pair of black trousers. This man leads us to a large marble staircase, which leads to the first floor to an antechamber with large walnut panels in which he asks us to wait. I spend a long moment looking over the weapons and pistols hanging on the walls of the room. Many servants pass by, busy cleaning the nicest house in London. After about a dozen minutes, a man comes to inform us that the prince is unavailable and we're invited to leave.
Oh, no. All right, then. Well, we are currently, for the record, at 23 leads. We could just take a swing at it and see what we got.
I feel like we're still missing, like, the central mystery of, like, how is the diamond stolen?
Well, I mean, we're only missing a couple of details of it, really. I mean,
like, how the diamond was stolen.
Well, more like who gave the combination over.
We don't know that, though. We're deducing that's only... that's probably what happened just because we haven't found any evidence to the contrary. We haven't found any evidence supporting it other than the fact that they supposedly have the diamond.
Well, I feel like
Well, that's an interesting... someone must have the diamond, or else it would be here.
Yeah. But we haven't found that either. So,
yeah, well,
I feel like we just need something. We need something to push us over in a direction.
Not entirely disagreeing, though. I feel like Wigan's statement at the end of the 92 West Central entry for the Savage Club, where he says no signs of tampering and, you know, you can't use a key to open it.
No,
I
absolutely.
I feel like that's disproving that it was anything but the combination. It's one of those statements they're making where you're not supposed to argue with it.
Maybe.
At the same time, they also say this was the work of a professional.
That's true. That's true.
You know, seems to be like that's also a statement.
Yeah, that's fair.
You
that's...
can read it both ways.
But we need the professional. Although I'd be willing to say a group of anarchists might have access to one just as a matter of course. Especially if they've been drifting into more subtle means.
I feel like we would have found some mention of safe-cracking stuff when we visited one of these places, though.
Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, we're looking for something that in all 23 of these places we haven't found any threads we can pull on for.
So I'm trying to think a little bit more about, like, the club and the people and whoever is associated with it.
We still never found the Brigham-man.
We didn't find the Brigham.
Like, which
the
is...
Brickman. The Brickman.
Kind of the only thread that connects...
Pass me a newspaper or two.
Two subplots.
How about them? Those are all the 98 ones.
Keep an eye out for anything related to Cantlemere. Mm-hmm. Or Sala, for that matter. We haven't, there's Christie's, the place where the diamond was being sold in the first place.
That actually might not be a bad idea.
We talked to the gypsy king.
Yes, but he won't give us any good information. Yes, there is an entry for Christie's, but it's very short.
Well.
Yes, the prince has made the acquisition of the Akbar Shah, which was delivered to the place of his residence, 6 Southwest St. James Palace. Sale's been announced to the press. It cost him about £30,000. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Have we... Okay, here's another one. Noonan had been brought up on charges of libel before.
Yep.
So that's some connection to this party.
Well, he was a newspaper man, too.
He was, but he was passionate about his cause.
Oh, yeah.
He was probably in on this whole plot where the lady got killed and he killed himself because someone had been murdered on account of his actions.
Well, no, I think he was killed by the other dude who is an expert in making them look like suicides.
Oh, maybe. Okay. Well, either way, he's in on it.
Well, he did write a note.
Why don't we... Yes.
Well, someone wrote the note.
I actually...
Should we compare the handwriting of the two notes?
We could.
Oh, wait, that letter's too damaged
yeah.
out from him.
Yeah. Hmm. Anyway, here's the point. If there were libel charges before, then there would be a record, which means Disraeli might have something.
That's fair. Want to go ask him?
I would. May I? I haven't had a good bite.
Yeah. Is he? Oh, it's in the back of this. Disraeli O'Brien. He's at 14 West Central.
Excellent.
14 West Central.
Ah! One sentence.
Oh.
Don't tell me you came here to get information on Lily Longtree, asks up bantering Disraeli O'Brien.
Lord.
I mean, actually, that makes sense, because Noonan is a pretty buried lead, and Disraeli
is
one of the ones on the back of the book.
It is indeed.
Okay, wait a minute. He works for the Times.
but the Times is Henry Ellis.
Oh, no, he works for...
Damn it, that's right. Oh, that's right, he works at the Pall Mall.
Yeah.
Let's talk to his boss.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, we haven't actually been to the Pall Mall Gazette.
Yeah.
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 Newspapes. Where am I going?
Pall Mall Gazette is at 90 Southwest.
Excellent. We'll crack this nugget yet. Nugget? Ah, here we go.
Polo wants chicken nuggets.
Polo! Excuse me. Uh-huh. The editor-in-chief of the Pall Mall Gazette is a bit shorter than average, shorter than any other NPC we've encountered tonight yet. He has a red beard and his pale blue eyes give his face an air of frankness and youth. His attitude matches that of his expression, frank and direct, almost childlike. During our investigation, we became interested in Marvin Pemberton's article printed in the Gazette. Ah, yes, that one. Gilbert Noonan had insisted that it be published. Apparently, they were close, he and Pemberton and Brougham. Society's upper crust, you could say. Both egalitarian ambitions. These men are deeply implicated in movements whose goal is to remove the monarchy of our country, an anachronistic and costly institution, according to them. Noonan covered their story. Could we see Noonan? I'm sorry, Gilbert Noonan isn't here right now. Do you know when he should be in? Actually, I'm very surprised by his absence. He didn't come in the morning and he hasn't sent a message. That's not like him. Do you think he'll be here tomorrow? Yes, as far as I know. Okay. Again with Brougham, though. So this guy actually knows who Brougham is. I'm going to be very embarrassed if there's an address in there after all, but...
It's spelled Broham, basically?
B-R-O-U.
Oh, yeah. Hail Broham.
God, 69. Damn it. We are dumb. We are dumb, dumb, dumb.
69 what?
Southwest.
61 N ice.
All right.
69 N ice. Damn it, I screwed up the joke. It's the internet number.
What did I say, 69 what?
Southwest?
Yes.
Okay.
Hail Broham.
I did it! I'm the murderer!
It's well known by most people who read the papers.
Well, most people, yes. Yes, of course.
Yeah.
He's a rich businessman from Manchester who spends his time defending social causes. We enter the luxurious suite, which is the man's London residence. How can I help you, gentlemen? We were hired by Mr. Sala to investigate the theft of the Akbar Shah at the Savage Club. Were you present on the night of the theft? Well, yes, as well as a dozen other club members. We remained together for the entire night, answers Brougham. But I can't think that Sala would suspect one of us. The diamond is of a historical interest, certainly. But most members of the club present that night would have had no trouble paying the £30,000 required to acquire it. And once stolen, it loses any value it has to us. And I don't know if you can talk about a theft in the end. Lily Longtree intervenes, Wiggins? Yes, I was as surprised as my friends seeing her wear them around her neck. I know her through common friends. She's a rising actress, probably too frivolous to be respectable. What is your opinion on the Prince of Wales? Despite his rank, he's a pleasant companion. I've never hid my Republican and anti-monarchist, but I've never hidden my Republican and anti-monarchist inclinations.
Hmm.
This guy... Didn't really hear. You want to check that out?
It's kind of anticlimactic, but yeah, then yeah. He was in the directory, so I guess he wasn't supposed to be a big find.
He's not really that suspicious, other than just...
I don't really understand this, though. And once it's stolen, it loses any value it has to us. What?
Well, I mean, you can't... If you've stolen it, you can't resell it.
Yeah.
That's... Oh, I see. That's true.
I mean, it's the property
of... If any of them steal it,
it's the property of the Prince of England. You can't... I mean, there's nowhere in England you can sell that.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Heck, even elsewhere in the world, in other countries, authorities would probably be obligated to return it if it ever popped up.
Hmm. Baffling.
But our American friend may not have thought that or known that.
You may have been just waiting for the heat to die down or something.
Yeah.
Although that would take a long time.
I think that he split from the group to do this forgery nonsense.
Yeah, I think that he was brought in by these socialists who had already stolen these papers from the other person.
Yep.
And was like, well, we can use this as an opportunity.
So maybe he is the thiefman that they brought in to just crack the safe, and we just don't know that he did that.
Which one?
The American.
David Laws.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's why he was able to take the gem on the slide to have it forged.
Well, they said it was all club members there, right? I mean, it was a reception at the club, but they really have not noticed this guy?
Oh, no, you're right, because there's no evidence to suggest he was at the scene. Huh.
Expert safecracker. Yeah. I just wish we had something that identified somebody as an expert safecracker, or either that or Candlemere as a socialist sympathizer who might have given the nomination.
Yeah, or Sala,
Well, Sala's the one who hired us. I would hope he would hire someone other than Holmes
You're correct.
Hiding something.
So, nothing implicates
either of them, unfortunately, at the moment.
And nothing places Laws at the scene of the crime.
Indeed.
You know, Laws would have had the opportunity because the diamond was on Lily's person.
Yeah, I mean, part of the scandal was for her to be wearing the diamond.
So that's when he would have taken it to go get it forged.
Or to have requested it if the physical copy wasn't necessary due to its being famous.
Yeah.
Huh.
So yeah, maybe he goes to get the forgery, comes back and finds his partner dead, and it's like, oh no.
He may have Quentin Hope, source of information on criminal cases, and might give us some insight into if someone we name has a locky picky background.
Which one?
Quentin Hope.
Have we not spoken to him already?
No.
We should absolutely.
Alright.
We might as well get all the leads.
I'm about to have to make a second row for leads.
I hope we get it right, because at this point we should get all the points.
Yeah, I hope so.
Yeah, it's going to be really embarrassing if it turns out it's like something completely different than what we've been thinking about for the past 2 hours.
Okay. Hog, it's a 35 EC.
They're like, oh, I hope hiding in that guy's room was a free lead.
Oh, here we are. Ah, Miss Longtree. I know her more for her files than for her talent. She has often been suspected but never found guilty. Remedying that shouldn't take too long. Quentin Hogg sweeps the crumbs from his vest with the back of his hand. He takes another bite from the dry biscuit, which makes a new avalanche of crumbs fall, replacing those which have just been slipped to the floor. I think that she and her accomplice Laws were no longer welcome in New York. That makes it easy to understand why she's trying to make a name for herself here now. Well. Crumbles.
Well.
That was lead 26.
All right, well.
I feel like, unless we've got some brilliant burst of inspiration, or something we think we've missed, I'll go over my notes again real quick, but we're pretty deep in the hole here.
Yeah.
Go to the entry for Cantlemere real quick. 55
for what?
South.
I'm sorry?
Cantlemere, 55 Southwest.
Yeah, not much about him, sadly. Just that he's a military man.
High ranking military officer. That frankly makes him, if anything, a less likely socialist, perhaps.
Yeah. I don't know.
We could visit Sala at his residence. See if he's got a copy of something interesting.
Isn't he at work right now?
Yeah, he might be at work.
Yeah.
But he almost certainly is. Well.
But he's not in the book anyway.
Oh, well, there we go.
Fine.
Gonna give it a swing?
Let's give it our best shot.
Alright.
I'm ready to be baffled by...
Well, we're not going to be too baffled. I think the only thing we could literally miss is how did they get into the safe. I think we have everything else.
Huh. Okay. Well, we might be better off than I thought we were.
All right.
The first series of questions has four questions. The first question is, why was the diamond stolen?
Political maneuver.
Socialism. Anarchism.
Anti-monarchy movement. Anti-monarchy political maneuvering.
Wait. Maneuvers sort of make sense.
Yeah, maneuvering.
It sounds to me like they want to...
discredit the monarchy.
Discredit the monarchy, plus fund the revolution in Serbia.
Well, it doesn't sound like a diamond can easily be turned to money.
No, but they're blackmailing the... No, they're not blackmailing. Yeah, that's right.
They totally...
Okay. I forgot about that.
Yeah, I mean, granted...
I made that up.
Granted, there's like 100 different ways you could word what we just said, so we'll take anything that's in the neighborhood.
Who killed Lily Longtree? Socialism. No, anarchism, excuse me. Nicola Pastiche.
Yes. Pastiche. Okay.
Three. Why?
Interesting. Why?
Because they didn't want to turn over the diamond.
But they were making a forgery. Why would they have cared about not turning over a diamond?
Maybe.
Because
they turned over the forgery.
Oh, you think they went there, huh?
Maybe, yeah.
Well, she was dead before. Well, maybe because she didn't have the diamond, because he was going to have the forgery made.
Maybe.
But we never heard that the forgery being made involved bringing the diamond to that guy.
That's...
to which guy?
To the forger.
To the forger.
No, but that does make more sense, that you have to have the diamond in order to impersonate it.
Okay, I can go with...
This isn't the kind of place where I could pull up the picture on my iPhone.
Okay, so I guess our theory is...
Yeah, let's... Can we timeline this out just
sure.
to make sure we don't get anything wrong here?
Well, I think we already got it, but I'll go over it rough real quick, and if we don't like that, we can go in detail. But I think Pastiche went to Lily, didn't see the diamond. Maybe he was looking for it, maybe he just wanted to check on it, because the diamond was at the forgery place, presumably, right? Because he had to pick it, because what's-his-name picked it up that morning.
He picked up the forgery that morning.
Yeah. Yeah, which if we're assuming the diamond had to be there for him to make the forgery, then he had to have picked up that as well,
yes.
Which meant it wasn't with Lily. So Nikolai shows up, for whatever reason, at Lily's place, diamond's not there, he gets upset.
Murders her.
Laws comes back from his errand, mm-hmm. sees her murdered, figures out, oh crap, I screwed up,
yep.
And gets out. The only thing I don't like about it is the assumption that the diamond had to be with the forgery guy. But that is a fair assumption.
That makes a lot more sense, really.
It does. So we're going to say that she was killed because she currently did not have the diamond, or because of the forgery? It's a little vague and lets us cover a bit better.
I want to say because she didn't have the diamond.
Okay.
At the same time, she was grabbed from behind.
That's so.
Well, grabbed from behind doesn't necessarily imply stealth.
Sure, that's true.
I mean, this guy's an experienced assassin. I'm willing to credit him with being able to pull that off on a civilian, basically.
I still think it makes more sense, but yeah.
She did not.
I'm just making sure that I don't let any crucial details slip through.
True.
Yeah, no, it's fair.
Question four, what will the policemen find when they search Laws?
The forged diamond, and perhaps also the real diamond.
Two diamonds.
Two diamonds.
Yeah.
Double diamonds. There are three questions in the second series of questions.
Okay.
The first is, who killed Gilbert Noonan?
Pastiche. Do we think...
I still think Gilbert Noonan did it.
There is the note. And I will say, I don't think anyone would have written that note even at gunpoint, because they would have kind of understood, if you're making me write a suicide note, you're probably going to kill me regardless.
Well, on the other hand, we didn't find a gun at the scene.
Oh. Yeah, right. That's actually true. I don't remember any mention of there being a gun at the scene.
Yeah.
So, do we want to say Pastiche then, or do we want to review that entry real quick?
Why don't we review it really quick?
Okay, I like that idea.
Noonan is where? I found it.
Oh, 73 Northwest.
Yes. Dark room.
The back door was open.
The back door was open.
Yeah, that's at least two things I think that point to it. But go on and finish reading.
Gunshot to the head. Eyes are wide open. As if they're... Okay. Well, it doesn't say to the front of the head. And it doesn't say that there's a gun. Yeah. So, let's say pastiche.
Okay.
The murder man. The sixth question. Why? Why is Noonan dead?
That's a good question.
It is a good question.
So he was the newspaper guy.
Yep.
They wrote an article. And he was in theory in good terms. In good terms. It was a newspaper guy in good terms. Why was he killed?
I don't know. I was convinced that he'd committed suicide because of his compliance with this death of the actress. Until just now, so I don't know.
Let me think for a second here. Well, what's question three while I think about that?
Who did the letters belong to?
Oh,
Kepner?
Yeah, Kepner. That's an easy one. Okay, so let's think about this question too a bit. Why would you kill Noonan in this scenario?
Okay, Noonan is part of this racket of socialists.
Yeah. He's a useful member to them. He's a newspaper guy. I mean,
right.
A newspaper guy is pretty handy if you're attempting subtle political maneuverings.
Only it turns out that this guy Pastiche is actually more of an anarchist.
Sure, but it's still useful even for an anarchist. I mean, he'd been useful up to this point.
Yeah.
Why would you suddenly now get rid of him? Unless, of course, by killing Lily Longtree, he had now put these guys on the hook for a murder instead of political maneuverings. Like, maybe they were okay with this whole, hey, we're going to discredit the prince, it's going to be great. But then when one of them turns up dead...
It could be as simple as because he knows too much.
Sure, that's true. But then why not kill the politician, too?
Because you couldn't get to the politician. As you may have noticed today...
Ah, that's so.
In fact, we don't know that he's alive, yeah. Necessarily.
Yeah, that's a good
so,
point.
So, knew too much. Knew too much.
Plus, I think that's about as good as we're going to be able to do.
And plus Longtree's death?
That sounds like two answers.
Oh, okay. Knew too much. Okay.
Okay.
That's it then.
Holmes is standing in front of the fireplace, his hands in the pockets of his gray housecoat, and his eyes fixed on Hale Brigham. And Charles Delicious sitting in front of him. The men aren't looking at Holmes or anything else in the room. Their eyes are fixed on a vague point of the chimney, and only leave that point when Holmes begins to talk. Very well, Lestrade. What did you think of the diabolical and ambitious plan thought up by these imbeciles? A plan which actually almost threw discredit on our future monarch and, in a context as tense as it currently is, very nearly lit the spark of a wind of revolt. All eyes turn to the two men who continue to stare at the fire. Lestrade, who has remained behind them, hungrily gnashing his mandibles together. Since he brought them in, bears a look of disdainful satisfaction. Watson shakes his head with a sorry look. Holmes lights a cigarette. These men are Republicans in the image of Robespierre. They believe that all ways are good if they help them reach their goals. How many innocents have died in the name of this logic. Two, in our case, Lily Longtree and Gilbert Noonan. I don't understand, Holmes. What were they hoping to accomplish? When we were called by His Royal Highness, it seemed obvious that this case of theft had something else. The diamond was only an accessory in a larger drama, while making His Royal Highness out to be an unfaithful skirt chaser. And the murder of Lily Longtree. Refinement brought by Charles Delicious, also known as Nicola Pastiche.
Oh, good, thank goodness.
The only violent anarchist of the group, and a man of action from a foreign land. I don't think that the others thought he'd go to such extremes. Wonder how much the others did simply as a game, due to a need to escape the ennui of their daily lives. Broom seems to boil at this, but decides to remain quiet. It's all a bit extreme for the expected result. Extreme for an anarchist? Smiles Holmes. You see, it wasn't even necessary for the prince to be found guilty of murder, or even having to prove that there was an extraconjugal affair. Considering his past indiscretions, all they had to do was raise the specter of suspicion and rumor. The press and public opinion would do their work, and the crown would be weakened that way. Press, of course, included the departed Gilbert Noonan, who built his career on universal suffrage and an anti-monarchy movement. But that's where you're right. He wasn't willing to be involved with a murder. I think that it's not when anarchists lay bombs that they're at their most fearsome, but when they sneakily slip into our society. Here's a new form of terrorism. How did you find them, Holmes? None of the band, in the name of their ideals, would sell each other out, and I was at a dead end. Time was short for all of us. I thus went to find Lestrade and insist on leading the investigation of Laws. When Broom hired Lily Longtree, she and Laws came up with a plan to double-cross them by making a fake diamond. Laws was coming in to make the switch of the fake diamond that very morning, but found the body of his accomplice instead. Our men knew only Lily Longtree and not her manager. With the right arguments, he proved cooperative to us. Once his confession was made, Lestrade was fast enough to block Prestige from fleeing. I still have the trial to say my piece, says Broom. Take them away, Lestrade. Lestrade grabs them both by the collar and pulls them upright. The two officers who were waiting in the corridor lead them out, followed by Lestrade. Mrs. Hudson enters and hands a letter to Watson. Watson, it's a letter from His Highness. He hands it to Watson, who crumples it and tosses it into the fire. Holmes, it's a letter from His Highness. Was, Watson, quite certainly a note of thanks and an offer of ennoblement. It would be an honor, Holmes. Holmes says nothing, lights another cigarette, and settles in his rattan chair. He looks fixedly at the fire. You know, Watson, I'm not entirely against the ideals of Hale Broom. Holmes! I don't agree with his methods, but people of high rank have a duty to be an example, Watson. I don't think that the prince has had an acceptable attitude toward his mother and the people. If he had been above reproach, he could have fixed this incident before it had degenerated. The end of our great queen's reign nears, and I feel that an era is also on the verge of ending. It's possible that a new age is beginning, but will it be a better one? Holmes solved the case with six leads. Porky, Paget, Convent Garden Theater, I apologize profusely, the Grand Hotel, Sir Everard Hancock, and the Cavendish Club. The lead 34EC, Ye Old Cheshire Cheese, is free.
Well, we didn't go there, so... So we used 26 leads, so we were in the hole by 100 at the moment.
Awesome.
Cheese, Watson. Hello. Question one. Why was the diamond taken?
Anti-monarchy political
maneuver. Yes, the theft of the diamond was to bring discredit to the Prince of Wales by making it appear that he was involved romantically with Lily Longtree. 30 points.
All right.
Who killed Lily Longtree?
Nicholas Pastiche.
Yes, 20 points.
Cool.
Why?
She did not have the diamond.
No.
Yeah, we figured that out from the answer.
Yes. I had never even thought of this, but yes, they were trying to frame the prince. Yeah. The death of Lily Longtree was intended to cause an embarrassing scandal for the Prince of Wales. If that death appeared to be a suicide, it could be even more embarrassing. Historically, the House of Hanover and its representative, the Prince of Wales, was unpopular among an important part of the British Republic. 30 points.
Okay.
Yep. What will the policemen find when they search Laws?
Two diamonds.
A fake diamond. 20 points. So I think we get 10 for that. Yeah, we do. Yeah. Who killed Gilbert Noonan?
Nicholas Pastiche.
He committed suicide!
With the back door open?
Apparently.
And no gun? This is an era of invisible guns.
That's the most terrifying era of all of history.
Or we'll shoot you.
Why? The plan that he had came up with got out of hand, and the unforeseen death of Lily Longtree consumed him with remorse. Oof. Damn it!
Oof.
Ah. Yeah. Who does the letters belong to?
Kepner.
20 points.
Oh, well, that's not terrible.
Yeah.
We're only in the hole by 20 points.
Oh, mercy.
Bleh.
Well, we were...
We had fun.
Yeah. No, that was a fun one. But they still never really answered how the safe got opened.
Well, it's happened to us before. We get fixated on one little detail that we can't figure out, and it turns out they never care.
It seems important, guys.
Yeah.
It seems important.
It does, but it wasn't.
Polo, you're so important.
Good boy.
Good boy, you did it. You solved anarchy.
I think he's scared you're gonna lift him up again.
No. Polo, thanks for playing with us. Thank you. Thanks for hanging out, friends.
Yeah. Thank you.
Next week we'll play the very last the very last mystery in this box of Sherlock Holmes adventures. And then we'll be working on something new. Join us next week for more fun and adventures. Have a wonderful night.
Bye.
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 Bye, Polo. Say bye, Polo.
Bye, Polo.